United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres visited Rafah over the weekend. The visit by Guterres comes as Israel faces global pressure to allow more humanitarian aid into Gaza. He says the UN will continue to work with Egypt to streamline the flow of aid into the besieged enclave.
A long line of blocked relief trucks on one side of the gates. The long shadow of starvation on the other. That is more than tragic. It is a moral outrage. Now more than ever, it is time for an immediate humanitarian ceasefire. It is time to silence the guns. Palestinians in Gaza, children, women, men, remain stuck in a non-stop nightmare. It is time for an ironclad commitment by Israel for total and fettered access for humanitarian goods throughout Gaza. And in the Ramadan spirit of compassion, it is also time for the immediate release of all hostages.
An Israeli airstrike hit Rafah early Sunday, killing seven and wounding several others. Over a million Palestinians are sheltering in Rafah, Gaza's southernmost town on the Egyptian border, after being displaced by Israel's offensive. But as Israel prepares for a ground invasion, the civilians there say Rafah is no longer safe. The international community has warned Israel against an assault in Rafah. But Israel continues to justify its planned move, claiming Rafah is the last bastion for Hamas. The Biden administration also continues to warn Israel over its planned invasion of Rafah. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris says such a move would be a huge mistake. But she stopped short of saying if there would be any consequences should Israel proceed with its plan.
Let me tell you something. I have studied the maps. There's nowhere for those folks to go. And we're looking at about 1.5 million people in Rafah who are there because they were told to go there, most of them. And so we've been very clear that it would be a mistake to move into Rafah with any type of military operation. We're going to take it one step at a time, but we've been very clear in terms of our perspective on whether or not that should happen.
Turning now to the brutal shooting in Russia. The first two suspects in the deadly Moscow concert hall attack appear in a Russian court. The two suspects, reported to be foreign nationals, have been charged with participating in a terrorist attack. Both have been remanded in a pretrial custody for 2 months. Friday night's attack, which killed 137 people and wounded over 180 others, has been claimed by Islamic State. Russian President Vladimir Putin says 11 people have been detained, including the four suspected gunmen. Russia's Federal Security Service claims the gunmen had contacts in Ukraine and were captured near the border. Russia lowers flags to half-mast as it holds a day of national mourning for the victims of Friday's attack. People have been laying flowers outside the concert hall where scores of people were gunned down in the deadliest attack inside Russia in 2 decades. Russian President Vladimir Putin also lit a candle in memory of the victims. Putin addressed the nation a day earlier and said the attackers had sought to escape towards Ukraine, with people on the Ukrainian side preparing to let them cross the border. Ukraine has repeatedly denied any role in the attack. President Volodymyr Zelensky also accusing Putin of trying to divert blame. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris laying the blame for the shooting massacre in Russia squarely on the shoulders of ISIS Khorasan or ISIS-K. Harris insists there is no evidence that Ukraine had any hand in the attack.
Vladimir Putin is already trying to link this to Ukraine and say that Ukraine is responsible. Does the U.S. have any evidence to back that up?
No. And first, let me start by saying what has happened in an act of terrorism and the number of people who've been killed is obviously a tragedy, and we should all send our condolences to those families. No, there is no whatsoever any evidence. And in fact, what we know to be the case is that ISIS-K is actually, by all accounts, responsible for what happened.
Russia violates Polish airspace in its ongoing offensive in Ukraine. Russia launched 57 missiles and drones Sunday, targeting several areas, including Kyiv and the western region of Lviv near the Polish border. Poland's defense minister says a Russian missile went 2 kilometers inside Polish airspace. The Polish foreign ministry intends to summon Russia's ambassador over the violation. Meanwhile, a part of a Russian cruise missile was found in a Kyiv park after it was intercepted. Ukraine's Air Force says defense systems destroyed 18 missiles and 25 drones. The strikes prompted residents to seek shelter in subway stations as sirens sounded across darkened neighborhoods. It's the 80s all over again. With a new Ghostbusters sequel and a reboot of Roadhouse, here's Manny the Movie Guy with a sneak peek.
There's something strange in the neighborhood.
Who are you gonna call?
Ghostbusters.
It's a sequel we didn't call for, Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. But the last one, Afterlife, made tons of money. So, here we are. This time, the Spengler's family, headed by stepdad Paul Rudd, left Somerville, Oklahoma, to go back to where it all began, New York City. But things are about to get chilly.
For the first time in New York history, people froze to death in the middle of July.
This one gives fan service to those who love the original. Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man? There's a bunch of them. But I must admit, I clapped when I saw the original cast.
But to get to do it alongside the original Ghostbusters was really the thrill of a lifetime.
Can I be of any help?
My big problem with the film, a lot of subplots that don't amount to much of anything. And this one takes itself way too seriously that it overshadows the fun. But at least the mid-credits scene will make you howl all the way home. And for that, Ghostbusters Frozen Empire gets 2 out of 4 Ecto-1 kisses. And streaming now on Amazon Prime Video, the reimagining of Roadhouse.
What? Your coverage good? Like, you have dental?
Oh, haha.
Yes, we didn't call for this one either, but at least it knows what it is. An all-out action film that truly delivers. Jake Gyllenhaal steps into the mighty big shoes of Patrick Swayze in the role of Dalton. He's now an ex-UFC fighter who takes a job as a bouncer at a roadhouse in the Florida Keys. From director Doug Liman, who gave us Edge of Tomorrow, among others, the action scenes are well choreographed, like the fights between Gyllenhaal and real-life UFC fighter Conor McGregor making his acting debut.
Looks like you're having a
Even if the original has a special place in your heart, this Roadhouse packs a punch. Oh, this one also has a mid-credits scene that is integral to the story. And for that, Roadhouse gets 3 out of 4 Take it outside, kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
For baby.